Well, the world is at an amazing juncture, and let's see if we can explain what's going on. I was listening to a YouTube video last night, a reading of A Course in Miracles, a certain chapter, and I picked up on what was being said very clearly. And what is being said is that this world is an attempt for us to insist that there's some power that outside of ourselves that is forcing us against our will to do things against our will. This comes from us trying to force something upon reality against the will of reality, which is namely to be greater than God. And so we're trying to prove that this is possible, because actually we are one with God. So if there's something that is controlling us against our will, that means there's some will that is stronger than God, because God created us the same as God, except that God was primary, or is primary. So we have the will of God, actually. So how could there be something controlling us beyond our will? That means that there's some will greater than God. So this world is an attempt to testify, to give witness to this belief. So I had a dream last night, and I saw very clearly that I've been trapped into this terrible situation in the world through lies and deceit, etc. And the main lie and deceit is that there is some will that is strong enough to do this to me. So really, it's part of that dynamic of this world. The world is a place where the belief that there's something affecting or controlling us outside of our own will for what is to happen, what our experiencing will be. And so when you come to this world and try to tell people, hey, look, there's no such thing as coincidences, there's no such thing as accidents, there's no such thing, everything that happens here is because that is our desire that it happen. We are actually totally in control of our experiencing. The world won't accept that. The world personality won't accept that. It will say, no. There's something happening to us beyond our own will that it happened to us. But paradoxically, what is happening in this world is the demand that we bow to this imaginary principle of some superior will forcing experience upon us, that, you know, one way or the other, that we're not in control. And so that's what happens. So this dream was incredibly profound. I'm very subdued and glum about the situation, because I see that my life has been controlled by something that it insisted it had the will, power to control me, when in fact it is merely this root projection, the notion that there's some will stronger than God, stronger than reality, and we're acting this out, we're acting this idea out here. So it seems incredibly difficult to counter this, which is why I haven't been able to break out of my circumstances yet. You know, that's what's so... And if you see this, you realize, wow, if I don't break out of it, I'm going to just remain trapped. It's not luck. It's not happenstance here. This is what Jesus was telling us. He says, look, you've got to identify, you know, what it is, what you're trying to do yourself. Because it's not something, some will outside of you that's causing your experiencing. So... Yet most of us, we want to believe it's just happenstance, and whatever bad comes to us, it's bound to go away and some replaced by something else, and our circumstances are bound to change and everything's bound to get better, and you know, luck. But what I saw in this dream is there's no luck to it whatsoever. It's very shocking, very sobering thing, because I thought if I don't somehow dissolve this complex, I'll remain trapped forever. You know, you have to see what's going on. It doesn't change of its own accord. No. Now, so this is a very difficult point to get to, for sure. And I've been kind of oscillating between, you know, feeling, should I get really depressed about this? Or should I be happy about it? Or what to do about this? Because it's a kind of a tricky situation, I realize. Very tricky situation. Severe disagreement of who's in charge of my life, actually. Or what's in charge of my life. Again, there's an insistence in this world. There's something external to us in charge of our life here. And that is a lie. That's a lie. So what the Holy Spirit suggested to me this morning is to say the following. All lies are lies forever. All lies are lies forever. A lie is a lie forever. So now we're getting into what to practice to evaporate this horrible complex that we're trapped in, that there's some sort of external force that is in control of our lives, of our experiencing. Now, I've said that the continuity problem, our dread of dropping this belief in some external force controlling us is so strong that we can continue to believe in this, which is true. So our real problem is the continuity problem. So how do we work on this as spiritual practicing? A lie is a lie forever. A lie is a lie forever. All lies are lies forever. A lie can never become true. A lie can never become true. A lie is a lie forever. No lie can ever become true. This is what was suggested to me to focus in on. So let's take a look at this. What I got in this dream is that the central belief is the belief that lies can become true. And therefore, our position that we need to, you know, get free of this delusion is not legitimate, because at some point the lie, which is there's some external control over our experiencing, not something other than our own will, actually, the lie is that will become true at some point. And so what we need to do to counter this is to say, lies are lies forever. A lie is a lie forever. It never will become true. It will never be true. A lie can never be true. A lie can never be true. No lies can ever be true. Truth is always true. Truth is totally true. Right now. A lie is forever a lie. Right now. Totally, a lie is totally a lie. A lie, all lies are total lies, okay? All lies are total lies. All lies are total lies forever. All lies are total lies forever. No lie can ever become true. No lie can ever become true. No lie can ever become true. A lie is a lie forever. So this is one of the most important practices. This directly is a way to directly confront this inner dynamic we have, that something is against our will is controlling our lives. This is a lie. Actually, we are just pretending that this is so. Just pretending that this is so. Lie is a lie forever. This lie will never be true. The lie about an external will never be true. This is a forever lie. This is a forever lie. The lie that there's some external will controlling our experiencing is a forever lie. It will never be true. It's a lie forever. I can feel this hitting hard, strong traction here. It's like one part of, it's like we're consigning ourselves to a life of misery, which is a reflection of our desire to consign reality to a secondary status, that it is secondary to our will that reality be different, or do we have a new reality, or the reality that we're in charge of reality, so reality is not the same as it was. We literally put ourselves into, are experiencing into a miserable condition where we feel inferior and neglected and trapped and all of this, just to prove, try to prove that we can subjugate reality actually. But we cannot subjugate reality, that's a lie. It's a forever lie. All lies are forever lies. All lies are forever lies. A lie is forever a lie. A lie is forever a lie. It never becomes true. A lie never becomes true. So, this dream, and it woke me up, and it is one of the more profound dreams you can possibly have. Is a fundamental argument over what's in control of your life. And to see, literally see, that you have been forced into like slavery by something that you think is you don't have power over to change, and you've been living in this nightmare is incredibly sobering and upsetting dream to have. So what I'm doing is I'm staying in the mood of repentance, which again is what I'm sharing as advice. It is the mood of repentance is the most important. It's the root practice of all practices. It's funny because it's not a specific practice. It's a general attitude, in that you're going to smooth out your responses, and you're not going to get extreme, and you're just going to remain calm and poised no matter what arises. No matter what arises, no matter what, you're going to stay calm and poised and non-reactive, non-emotive. You're not going to get bitter or blame or anything like that. So this enables us to handle this type of experience of seeing this, which is just an incredible bitter type of experience, and also promising. But again, I think most of us would say, "Well, wow, I'd rather just get lucky than to see that if I don't solve this dilemma, I'm never going to get free." That's what I saw. And so it requires us to be committed to the mood of repentance. So I just said, "Well, I'm committed to this mood of repentance. So I'm just going to just try to stay as even keel as possible, and not pursue any sort of emotionalized reaction or any type of reaction, and just stay calm and just stay confident. Stay calm and stay confident that it's going to tip in the right direction." Now Jesus says that once we see these hallucinations, these delusions, once we look and see what's going on, that seeing itself evaporates them. So we'll see how that goes. That's a hopeful thought for sure. The gist of that idea is that it's better to see it than not see it. It's better to face it and look at it. And then remain in the mood of repentance, where you're not trying to desperately struggle with something. Mood of repentance, you're not desperately struggling with anything. You're not getting angry, you're not getting depressed, you're not maybe even getting like euphoric. That you're staying sort of confident, mildly optimistic, confident, poised, quiet, sober, serious. I've been very, glum today. Like, wow, this is just incredible. What I've done to myself, really. We're all doing this to ourselves. that I imagine some authority over me, which has dictated to me that I remain like a slave and live a life that I absolutely hate. And just a brutal life, really. And this has been dictated to me. This life has been dictated to me as like a total scam, total unfair, something totally unfair. And just so this supposed other will can seem to lord it over me and be superior to me. So I've lived a life of feeling inferior, you know, to everything somehow, that I don't have the will to do to experience what I want to experience. The whole life has been that way. So that's a very sober kind of thing, realization. But what I'm sharing here is it's possible to have this sober realization, to see it and have this arise in your awareness and look at it. But it certainly takes maturity of the mood of repentance. It takes a certain kind of maturity. Now maybe you had that maturity in another lifetime and now you're a young person and it's easy for you. You can do it. That's possible, of course. Or you're like me, you've been working at your whole life to get to this point. What you try to do is you try to stay non-reactive to it and you stay in the mood of reason. Stay in the mood of just pure reason. Not saying, oh my gosh, I'm never going to succeed. Or I have to force this success right now or something. No, just say, okay, be patient. Now it's a beautiful day here. It's like summer here. It's ridiculous. We've had another heat spell of the day. You know, it's just like everybody's just out recreating and doing stuff. But here I am, sitting around the house, doing nothing, and just taping. But the thing is this will, this imaginary external superior will, is going to put me in the grave. Is going to ruination is its goal. Ruination is its goal. It's trying to prove that I don't have the will to escape the ruination. That's what's, you know, rather alarming. And the ruination is right at my doorstep, actually. So it's very timely that I see this. Now, here's a little bit of advice. What I found is that listening to something is interesting. It's a different experience than reading it. So I've been listening to someone narrate A Course in Miracles, just kind of in a neutral narration. They're not adding any of their own input or emphasis at all, just neutral. So I'm listening to it. And I'm able to hear stuff very well. It's different than reading. And actually, I find it to be very, very helpful. So all I do is I just put the headphones on, and I don't look at the video. I just listen. I'm just listening, trying to concentrate on what's being said. It's not easy. Because some things are just... And I'm picking up on a lot of help. So that is something that is possible. I've never done this before. Never listened to any audio of anything really as a Course in Miracles or anything like that. Only reading. My eyes are so bad now, I really can't read very well at all. So listening, I find listening is wonderful, very helpful. And I think a neutral narration is better. Like if I did it, I would put my own emphasis on it. I'd really emphasize stuff in it. But that's trying to, you know, I think people would feel like something's being imposed upon them, some sort of emphasis. Whereas a neutral reading, just a flat out neutral reading, and not always necessarily with the right emphasis, right punctuation, you know, the right. So it gives you an opportunity to kind of get your own insights as you're going along and pick up on it. I find that's very helpful. But I don't think if I did, it would be very helpful. because I would definitely put my own emphasis on what I believe to be, you know, how it should be read. But a neutral reading lets you decide how you want to take it. Very interesting. And the information there is profound beyond belief. It is so profound that it almost seems like too much for us, really. But you know, we're getting the right information. I can tell you that for sure. One way or the other, the right information seeps through. This whole world is indeed projection. Projection makes perception. That is absolutely true. And we are in a bizarre situation here in the world. Very bizarre. Now, Jesus talked about that the world can be a wonderful place full of joy, and if we find that the world's a terrible place, that's because we're trying to crucify God, etc., etc. I just have to listen to that. But then on the other hand, he does say this world's an extremely difficult, terrible place as far as, you know, getting caught up in the wrong belief system here, etc., which is true. So there's several ways to look at it. You just have to take whatever you can get from whatever teaching you're listening to. Take whatever you can get. Because from what I have seen, the vision of oneness, the vision of shared identity of everything, is definitely what we're aiming for. Now, of course, once you see the vision of shared identity, vision of oneness, the world is not just the world that's paradise. It's not the universe that's paradise. It's everywhereness that's paradise. So Jesus did say you're either going to choose one or the other. Either you're going to choose the world to see as a misery, or you're going to see it as absolute joy. I agree. I can understand that. But it's one or the other. So if you choose the world as joy, it's going to be not just this world, the whole universe. It's going to be this everywhereness, smoothed out, perfect joy of shared identity. We can't even describe the feeling, really. It's not a personality feeling. So you're either enlightened or you're not enlightened, basically. And if you're not enlightened, this world's definitely a terrible, terrible ordeal. For sure. And we shouldn't go after the kind of fake happiness. It's a waste of time. It's a waste of time for sure. So what we do is we go after the vision of oneness, which is the Holy Spirit's perception. That the Holy Spirit's perception, it has no distancing factor to it. Sensory perception has this distancing factor to it. Which we're being like totally invaded by crows here, as you can hear. Sensory perception has a distancing factor to it, which builds up what we call the personality. The personality cannot understand truth at all. It thinks it can, because it's functioning to try and judge. It's a judgmental thing, so it tries to judge truth. Truth is not something that can be judged. And so the personality keeps believing it can get it. The personality can't get anything. It can't get truth at all. Absolutely cannot get it. And what the world does is the world personality here, it thinks, oh, we're getting it. We're almost there. Meaning, lies have almost become true. So one way to free yourself from this delusion is that lies can never become true. A lie is a lie forever. Huge flock of crows. I'm just looking at it. My gosh. And they're just going around like the brown shirts, terrorizing the neighborhood, really. Phew, man. Look out. Um, personality insists that it can get it, and it can't. It can never get truth. It can never be enlightened. It's impossible. Personality. So when we're talking here, we're talking to a spirit. We're talking to spirit. We're not talking to personality. So just ignore the personality and its conclusions and its reactions and stuff. That's the mood of repentance. Just ignore the personality. Ignore the personality. It's not a person. It's not a identity. It's not a self. It's merely the activity of judgment. Perception is judgment. It's a type of judgment. It's a false, and it draws false conclusions. It about God. Because with God, God is everywhereness. Total, perfect, seamless everywhereness. Everything is totally abiding in God. At the very center, very heart of God, always. Heart of God is everywhere. The center of God is everywhere. Omnipresence is everywhere. Close, equally close, everywhere. So everything is equally abiding in God. So there's no judgment in terms of location whatsoever. But perception is a locational judgment situation. And so it inherently draws false conclusions about reality, about God, about identity. And all these false conclusions coalesce as a constellation of belief, which we call the personality, which we call our self. It's not our self. It's not even a self at all. It's no identity whatsoever. It's a false, delusionary, illusory type of conclusions, misbelief, mistaken belief. So when we hear truth, the personality is going to react for sure. Well, the mood of repentance is to just ignore the personality. Don't respond to the personality. A lie is a lie forever. When the personality reaction comes up, just say, a lie is a lie forever. A lie is never true. These are called tautologies, or tautological statements, which is kind of obvious, making obvious statements, which are very important to mute the personality. Because the personality thinks that it can judge, it can tweak judgment in any which way it wants to. So it thinks that it can make something true, make a lie true, just by locational adjustments and say, well, let me take a look from this angle over here and I can see it that way or something. No, a lie is a lie forever. A lie is a lie forever. A lie is never true. No lies ever become true. All lies are lies forever. This is a very powerful statement to make, which the Holy Spirit shared with me this morning when I was in this very difficult situation. I have only one will, and that will, I shared that will with the will of God. There's only one will. I have only one will, not two. There is no external will. Deny that, and that's a lie. A lie is never true. A lie is never true. A lie is never true. Mood of repentance mutes the personality and says, I refuse to engage in any dialogue with the personality. Because we have the vision of oneness waiting for us, and that replaces the personality in terms of judgment. We realize there's just one judgment, and that is one shared identity, everything sharing the same sense of identity, nothing being excluded from that, which reminds us of reality. So there's no personality judgments needed in order to remember our identity. See, the personality keeps thinking it's in charge of our identity. Like there's some external will in charge of our identity that is somehow supposedly leading us to our identity as an external will. and the personality believes it's in charge. The ego, the personality believes it's in charge of identity. So it always wants to butt in and have its two cents worth. Don't give it the opportunity. Ignore it. Just be deaf to the personality, really. It has nothing to say, nothing to add that can help us in any way. It's only the Holy Spirit that can help us. So the spiritual practicing is really what the Holy Spirit suggests. The personality wants to talk about it forever. It loves talking about it, but never practicing. Because practicing mutes the personality. Where you feel, hey, the personality doesn't matter because I have something that really works. I don't need to ask the personality what it thinks or what it suggests. The personality loves to be consulted. It's like a consultant says, I'm your consultant about identity. Now, the personality comes from the belief that there's an external will, external to the will of God, actually, which is our true identity and which is in charge of our lives. So this is a lie. So the personality really is advocating a lie, that a lie can become true. So what we say is a lie can never become true. A lie can never be true. And this has a tremendous impact on our psyche. I'm feeling it. A lie can never become true. Our whole entire experiencing in this world is based on the belief that lies can become true. If we didn't believe that, we would not have been experiencing any of this. We would be experiencing the vision of oneness for sure. Absolutely. So, if we're not experiencing the vision of oneness, the vision of one shared identity for all, everything, just one shared identity, which is located everywhere. If we're not experiencing that, for sure, we're believing that a lie can become true, for sure. So the way to turn it around is to say a lie can never be true. This really is pulling the ego, the personality up by the root, up by its central root. A lie can never be true. A lie is a lie forever. Truth is always true, and lies can never be true. Truth is true forever, and a lie is a lie forever. And a lie can never be true. Truth is true forever. Now, this may seem very simple, and it is, but it's extremely powerful medicine. The medicine that we need to be taking in this world is this type of medicine. This is the medicine we need to be taking. And the problem, the world is so incredibly problematical, trying to prove that there's an external will in control of us, which means in control of reality. That it pursues this in a completely fanatical manner. And so we have been brainwashed, subjected to intense pressure, belief pressure, personality pressure, egoic belief pressure, perception pressure, to believe that there are these external influences in our life that we have no control over, and they bring sickness and problems, and yet the answer is to take medicine, a pill. The answer is doctors and pharmaceuticals and all this kind of stuff. As the ultimate answer, and then we have no recourse other than that, and anyone who tries to have some other recourse is somehow fundamentally flawed in their belief and need to be corrected. Whereas this is completely backwards, upside down and backwards. The right medicine we need are these right declarations, right affirmations, right statements of truth. A truth is always true and can never become a lie. Lies are always lies. A lie is a lie forever. A lie can never be true. This is the right medicine that we need to use. This is an example of right healing, right medicine for our problem. This addresses our problem at its very root. And almost no one in the world is being trained in this way, which is why I have a very gloomy, you know, assessment of the future of this world in terms of near term. There certainly are many, many flashpoints around the world, many flashpoints. And the whole projection and attack syndrome here is so strong. And the indoctrination, again, who has the mental techniques to truly heal themselves from insanity? Who has been practicing that? How many of the percentage? Is it 50%? I mean, there are 50% of the world practicing that truth is always true and lies are a lie is a lie forever and lies can never become true, and practicing these intense spirits, like with 50% of this is spending what, 8 hours a day doing this? Is that true? Or maybe it's 25%, or maybe not even that much, maybe even 10% of the world. Or actually look around and say, well, maybe it's not even that, maybe it's 1% of the world. And then you keep saying, who's actually doing this? And you say, maybe just a handful of people on the planet, actually. So a handful of people on the planet is supposed to carry the day? I don't see how that's possible. You cannot force anyone to let go of the belief that there's some external will controlling circumstances. You can't force that, because literally their will desiring that this is so in the first place. And you cannot, all will is one, you cannot force, you don't have a stronger will than somebody else. Nobody, everyone has equal will, actually. It's just how you use it. And so if somebody wills that they want to believe there's some external will stronger than them, that's their will that is producing this delusion for them. You cannot force a change in that. So for me, it's the personality is claiming everything's fine here. That is the answer. The personality says, don't worry, I've got the answer. Everything will be fine. I'm going to, I'll find a way for sure, don't worry. That's been the history, how many ways have been found. Mostly what happens is conflict, which comes from this fundamental principle of projection and feeling of misery and failure projected out there. I mean, it's kind of like saying, like, well, there's this external will that is that's making me unhappy, but if we join together in a group, we can attack this and defeat it. That's what happens in the world. All this group activity in the world, it sounds great, but are they really getting after right spiritual practice, which is something that any person, any one of us can do just sitting in our room or walking to school or going, driving to work or resting, whatever. It doesn't take a group to do this. So when I see groups, for me, I see people saying, you know what, if we join together, we'll have a stronger will, and that stronger will can then be used to defeat what we feel is some will trying to control us, you know, and make us unhappy. And that only exacerbates the problem, actually. There is no stronger will, so we don't need some group to, you know, change it. We can change it just right where we are, just by these right spiritual practices. Now, it may help, these right spiritual practices, it may help doing it in a setting where there are others there to just kind of encourage you. That's legitimate. But as far as trying to change the world that way, not an attack, projection and attack. There is no external will controlling us. It's all our own projection. It's the projection of our desire, our will, that this be what the situation that reality is under, some external will to reality, which we want to be us. We want to be the prime creator, whereas our will is greater than the will of God, and we're the ones who are actually the prime creators of reality. That's what we're trying to get to, and we can't get there because it's not true. Truth is always true right now. Truth is totally true right now. Truth is totally true right now. And lies are totally lies right now. All lies are total lies right now. This is the medicine that we actually need. Now, we don't have to stop other medicines, of course not. You're sensible, you're pragmatic, and you're sensible. We're not talking about that at all. What we're talking about is merely applying the true medicine. What actually works is what we're talking about. The other stuff is fine, placebos. Just use it to control whatever situation that you have health-wise. But realize this is just part of this overall complex we have of believing that lies can be true. But you do not fix it at the level of effects, okay? So if you say, well, I'm gonna stop taking medicine, that's at the level of effects. You don't do it that way. You do it at the level of causation. And so when you say a lie is a lie forever, that's at the root level of causation, where you're expressing a willingness to set down projection, perception, personality, belief system, person, projection, perception, belief system, personality, willing to exchange that for the Holy Spirit's perception, which is the total cure. Saying these right spiritual practice is like taking medicine. The vision of oneness is like a miraculous cure where that no more medicine is needed to be taken. Once we have the vision of oneness, spiritual practice essentially is no longer needed. Just abide in that, and that's all we have to do. Now we can help others, encourage others on sharing with them, but once the vision of oneness dawns upon us and we abide in it, we're cured. We're totally cured. But until then, we have to apply right spiritual practice. And because we're ambivalent about it, we also, if we're taking medicine or getting some therapy or whatever, we need to also do that as pragmatism dictates. Realizing that is not going to deny you anyone vision of oneness. It's not going to deny it at all. But as far as the root delusion, vision of oneness cures the root delusion. Now the body may continue on the way it continues on. You might even still have high blood pressure or something, and maybe you need to take something for it. That's possible, sure. Absolutely, it's possible. So we're just continuing on here, using our time wisely, because there are infinite ways to squander our time here. And if we don't use the right medicine here, for sure we will continue on with this very, very sick syndrome of some external will that is dictating our experiencing. Where we go, what we do, how we feel, our circumstances, everything. We'll continue on with that, and we'll just keep hoping that maybe if we work hard enough, if we get lucky, and then blame God, of course, for when things don't work out right. We'll say, ah, God, you don't care about me, and it will continue. We'll continue on with that, life after life after life. So, right use of time is to apply the right medicine, which is right spiritual practice. All lies are lies forever. A lie is a lie forever. A lie is a lie forever. It's very important to speak in absolute terms in right spiritual practice. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. It's very absolute, it's the only one. Always try to speak in absolute terms in any sort of spiritual practice you're using. Because that shuts the personality out right there, right? You're saying, there's only one way. Truth. Truth is true. Lies aren't true. Truth is true. Lies will never be true. Basically, that's what you're saying. Lies will never be true. Never. See the term? Never. All lies will never be true. Total, abstract, you know, complete statement. Never. Personality hates those terms. It refuses to use those terms. Because it's all about transitioning from a lie becoming true. So the personality is all about compromise and consensus, building consensus, building compromise. That's the personality. Says, well, how do you feel about that? How do you feel about that? That has nothing to do with salvation, with right spiritual practice. Right spiritual practice is very adamant. It says, a lie is a lie forever. Now, if you feel like, I'd love to hear that, then you know that you're getting free of the personality complex. Whereas if you feel just really like, I just hate that, I can't stand that, that's the personality complex, and you have to work on it. You have to practice, you have to practice. The personality is a real bully. It's the bully we are projecting upon ourselves, actually. We project it outward, and then it comes back to us, and we think it's some external will. But we're doing the projecting. We're projecting the super bully upon ourselves. Have to stop the projection. So exchange the projection, our projection, for the perception of the Holy Spirit. Truth is always true. Truth is totally true. Truth is totally true. Now, truth is totally true. No wiggle room. Truth is totally true. Truth is totally true. There's no aspect of truth that isn't true. Truth is totally true. Lies are totally lies. All lies are forever lies. All lies are forever lies. This is a projection buster for sure. All lies are forever lies. No lie will ever become true. Lies never become true. Lies never become true. Never, 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 never. So there's nothing for the personality to say. Now, when I say this world right now, I would say it's the cult of personality in the world, the cult of the personality. And what you have in this world, those people who have the public ear, because they have bought into the personality to an extreme extent. That is why I say it is such a bad thing to pay attention to those who have the public ear in whatever media they're moving in through whatever groups that they're, you know, pushing their influence and their point of view through. There's so many, 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 many groups, different types of political, social, all these various things in the world that are backed by various people, very powerful personalities, and they're projecting, they're pushing the viewpoint of the personality upon everybody on this planet. You get it everywhere. You get it on all media for sure. And it's a ruinous thing for us, ruinous. And so they're all about, the world is all about the personality now. It's all about the personality. And even, you know, the whole way that Jesus is being talked about in this world, I find it appalling. They're turning Jesus into a personality. That's what's happened. Some of the stuff I see, it's just wow, is all. You know, just move on from it, right? But it's important to note that's what's happening to the world. Jesus has become just a real nice person, or a social activist person, or a person who's, a strong personality, a nice personality, a kind personality. But it's all about personality now. Everything in the media is about personality, isn't it? Totally, 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 totally about personality. This is the heart of delusion. If you have no personality, you go nowhere here, right? Nowhere. You got no personality. You're seen as a leper, basically. Whereas the right way is to use the language of clarity, to speak at the level of spirit, not personality. Do not appeal to the personality. Personality will get bored and say, ah, there's nothing here. Nothing here. See here. Move on. Yeah. Well, lies will never become true. A lie is a lie forever. And that basically says the personality is kaput, has no purpose, has no value. Personality has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value. The personality has no value for me. And then you can name all the problems the personality is working on and say it has no value for me. The population problem has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. All the problems are testimony to the belief there's some external will, a will external to us. All problems, except the continuity problem, which is simply arises out of familiarity. And we're afraid to set our problems down. One minute, please. All right, little interruption there. The cult of the personality. We live in the cult of the personality in this world. There's no question about that. And the problem is the personality insists that it's not a cult, and it insists that it's very spiritual, and it insists that it's getting enlightened, and it insists it's doing the right thing, and it insists that it's going towards a really great situation. It insists on all of this. Utter nonsense. All the while, totally neglecting right spiritual practice. Right spiritual clarification, totally neglecting it. This is what's happening. And anyone who says otherwise is a heretic. Anyone who challenges the cult of the personality of this world is deemed a heretic. A very dangerous situation in those terms. Personality refuses to admit that what the situation is. It insists that it's benevolent. It insists on its benevolence, okay? It insists upon it, even though things can be absolutely terrible based on the actions of the personality-driven actions. It will insist that it is very benevolent. You might wonder, why are dictators, what happens in the world here? What's the matter with them? Caught up in the cult of personality. And the personality, again, insists that it's totally benevolent, very benevolent, very enlightened, very benevolent. It's just helping people, just helping people, just helping. And it doesn't recognize what it's doing. It's a madness. You might say, again, the world's an insane asylum, actually. Thank you. I don't know if that was a yes or a no. So you cannot explain this to the personality. It's impossible. It just kind of went in one ear and out the other, and then it just continues on with its spiel. So how to help that situation is difficult to understand. Sometimes you just have to back off of it. People are looking for stronger and stronger personalities in the world, more and more clever personalities. We're addicted to the cult of personality here. It's just incredible. A truly enlightened being will seem to have no personality at all, really. They'll just be completely calm, blissful. I mean, in a state of this smooth, precious feeling of everything is near and dear and blissful, smooth, and that's it. There isn't anything else. There's no personality, instability there. And so the personality doesn't understand what that was. You must be a super personality. How do I become a super personality? You can't. You don't. There's no such thing. There is no such thing as a super personality. The more we go towards a super personality, the more we go towards extraordinary, terrible situation. You get dictators. You get people who think they know more than anybody else and are able to fix all the problems of the world. And you get 5-year plans. I mean, right? You get the world has seen it many, many times. You get those who are certain they have the answer for human happiness, and even if that means pulling everybody up by the roots and doing all these drastic programs, et cetera, et cetera, they'll do it. And they think it's all benevolent for everybody. It's all going to work out great. And there's nothing wrong with it whatsoever. That's the personality. The personality is not a self. It's not a self. It's a belief system which believes it can become the self, a new self. So it feels it's evolving into a self. There's this idea that truth doesn't evolve. Okay, truth is true, totally true right now. No such thing as an evolving truth. No such thing as evolving lie. Lies don't evolve into truth. So what is all this evolution? It's the cult of the personality. Nothing is happening in terms of truth. Nothing is happening in terms of lies. And so nothing is really happening at all in terms of change. Truth is totally true now. The totality of truth is here now. The totality of truth is always here now, in its entirety. Totality of truth in its entirety is forever here now. So these are, listen to the absolutes, the entirety, absolute, the entirety of truth, absolute, is totally, another absolute, totally present, total, that's another total abstraction, now, again, another statement of complete abstraction there. The entirety of truth is totally present now. That's the language of spirit. That's the language of spirit. And personality was a little say, well, what do you mean by that? What do you mean by that? What do you mean? What do you mean? What do you mean? Because I believe in evolving. I'm evolving. Personality says, I'm evolving. I'm a lie evolving into a truth. No, no. All lies are forever lies. No lie can change into truth. lie can ever change into truth. Again, very absolute statements, absolute words. Using absolutes as your vocabulary is very, very important and helpful. Because actually, the vision of oneness is an absolute, one shared identity, without a second, without a second. One, it's an absolute, shared, absolute, identity, absolute, without, absolute, a second, absolute, one shared identity without a second. The whole statement is an absolute. So, right spiritual practice is not to try to find some consensus, build consensus or build a compromise. It is to state truth, to use absolutes to reinforce your commitment and acceptance and comfort zone with truth, with the vision of oneness. Actually, the vision of oneness is totally now. Vision of shared identity is totally now. And lies can never be true. The vision of oneness, of shared identity, the vision of shared identity is totally here now, and lies can never be true. So what I'm suggesting here in the practice, whatever you practice, end the practice with, and lies can never be true. And lies are lies forever. This puts like an exclamation point on whatever we're doing. This plant, the radiant presence of this plant blesses those stones. There's the chain of, let me see if I can get that, it was yesterday. Those stones are blessed by the radiant presence of the one shared identity of this plant. And that tree is blessed by the radiant shared one identity of those stones. And this post is blessed by the radiance of the one shared identity of that tree. And that roof is blessed by the radiant one shared identity of this post. And that tree is blessed by the radiant one shared identity, radiance of the one shared identity of this roof. And that sky is blessed by the radiant one shared identity, radiance of the one shared identity of that tree. And then that hedge is blessed by the radiance of the one shared identity of the sky. And lies can never be true. And lies can never be true. All lies are lies forever. All lies are lies forever. So it's putting an exclamation point on whatever practice we use. The one shared identity of this plant spaciousness, of this plant appearance, of this plant spaciousness, the one shared identity of this plant spaciousness, blesses the one shared identity of that wire spaciousness, blesses the one shared identity of that barbecue spaciousness, blesses the one shared identity of that table spaciousness, blesses the one shared identity of those stones. Stone spaciousness, blesses the one shared identity of that sun spaciousness, blesses the one shared identity of those pine needle spaciousness, blesses the one shared identity of concrete spaciousness, which blesses the one shared identity of this palm tree spaciousness, which blesses the one shared identity of this flower spaciousness, which blesses the one shared identity of this plant spaciousness, which blesses the one shared identity of all, which blesses the one shared identity of this spaciousness right here. And lies can never be true. And lies can never be true. All lies are forever lies. Truth is totally true right now. All truth is totally true right now. All truth is totally true right now. Now, it may seem that this is very severe and extreme. Of course, it has to be effective. Because this complex of this alien external will that is, you know, forcing us into servitude, this is a very terrible dynamic that we're trapped in, like the jaws of death. Really, it is the jaws of death. It's literally the jaws of death. So we gotta pry those jaws open. Gotta use a hydraulic jack to pry those jaws open. So the right spiritual practice is like an intense hydraulic system of leveraging the pressure to pry open those jaws of death. So that's why we're using these techniques that have that hydraulic leverage, heavy fluid leverage that just makes tremendous pressure to open those jaws of death. The weather's out of sync for sure. This is so out of sync. It's just wow. Nevertheless, no matter what the weather is, we have to be working on those jaws of death. It could be the most beautiful day we've ever seen. Still, we have to work on prying those jaws of death open. Here we are doing it. I mean, this, like I said, you can hear all the motorcycles all over the place. People are out with convertibles. I mean, they're in shorts. I mean, it's just like they're luxuriating in this incredible weather this whole winter. This is just another, you know, just sun-baked day with beautiful, like, summer-like clouds. And here we are, just absolutely working intensely, working here in most difficult situation. Maintaining a tremendous effort to keep the personality from taking over the situation. The personality often says, okay, I get it, I'll sing a song. I know you just want me to, you're just really, oh, you're relating to this song. Okay, that's what you're talking about, this song that I know, and I'll start singing this song. No, that's not it. The song is not it. The practice is it. Personality thinks that songs are sufficient. Songs are sufficient, isn't it? Songs are not sufficient. Vision of oneness is what is sufficient. Vision of one, the one shared identity. Identity being derived from the perception of the Holy Spirit, which sees no significance or gradation whatsoever from location or appearance. Appearance, location, all of that makes no difference. Everything is equally seen, is being seen, is being awareness is equally aware of everything. everywhere, equal awareness, equal vision of everything everywhere. And this one shared identity we have is this identity of being truly seen. Truly seen. And everything also being truly seen. We live now we say we live in a universe where everything is truly seen. The universe of fairness, the universe of true equality. And we feel this identity of perfect equality, perfect fairness, perfect love, we call it love, perfect compassion, perfect benevolence. We feel this. As this is the one shared identity. This is the identity that we share with everything. This is identity. And we're sharing that. We are in that. And so this is the great, great experience we have to look forward to. No matter where we are, no matter what we look like, we are abiding in this one shared identity with all, with everything. Not less, not more. No way we can lose it. No way anything can lose it. Total security of identity. Eternal life. Of everything. No external will to change this. Just this continuum of smoothed out bliss, a continuum of smoothed out shared identity, just a continuum, a seamless continuum. A seamless continuum of sacredness. A seamless continuum of blessing. Now, an interesting thing about living out in California is we get so much incredible great weather here. Eventually you realize that that's not the answer. Whereas if you live like in a place where the weather is very harsh, then you think, wow, we come out to California, like the weather's the answer. For a long time, maybe the weather will feel like it's the answer for you. I just need a nice day. And you think, you know, I'll just wait. When I'm having a problem, I'll just wait. Until the weather changes and then we have a nice day. And that'll solve whatever problem I have. That's how we feel here. But if you live here your whole life, you eventually get wise to it and say, hey, it doesn't matter how nice the day is, that's not the answer. But most of us, oh my God, look at the day, let's go to the beach. Oh my God, let's go to the mountains. Oh my gosh. Let's go bicycling. Oh my gosh, let's just, you know, let's go do something. Let's go to a concert. Oh my gosh, let's, you know, whatever people do, I don't know what they do, but they're certainly not sitting here like this. So it's a curse and a blessing. If you can finally see through this, the whole weather thing and the whole climate thing and all this stuff, that's not the answer. If you can finally see through that, then you're in very good shape. Because whatever weather, good weather we have in this world is certain to disappear. Certain to disappear. What we want is perfect weather that never disappears. and the so-called perfect weather that never disappears is the one shared identity. That's better than weather. It's better than perfect weather, believe me. Having seen so many ideal days in California, either, you know, in Santa Barbara, in Palm Springs, in the Bay Area, you know, I've seen it all. I've seen just days that you say, ah, might as well die today because it's not ever going to get any better than this. And so, but having seen the vision, glimpsing the vision of oneness, that's incomparably better to the most wonderful climate day in this world. Incomparably better. You can have days here in this world where you feel it almost touches upon the vision of oneness, but that day doesn't last, does it? And it doesn't quite get there. I remember one day like that. But it's still personality, because it was like perfect day where I was, but the rest of the country, it was like this, December 25th, I think it was Christmas Day, the day after Christmas, it's freezing all over. And I was in like the Palm Springs area, and it was like absolutely perfect. It was so crystal clear and blue. All the waters goldenly sparkling. The grass was emerald green, and it was just like just a hint of a breeze. It was just like the most incredible day. And you realize that most of the rest of the world is not even remotely touching upon this. And so your personality gets kind of a kick out of this. It's sort of a personality that says, wow, I'm special, or something, you know, this is really, you know, a blessing for me. But remember, vision of oneness is the one shared identity that is shared by all. So everything is experiencing this one shared identity. Everything is included. So it's not just you. See, it's everywhere. It's a different thing. It's not a personality triumph of like, oh, I've managed to find the perfect day in the perfect place. That's the personality. It's that everything, without exception, has found this perfect one shared identity. Everything has found it. That's better than I have. Let's say I have found it. It's everything has found it. And it makes us so happy. It makes us blissful. I say, I'm so happy that everything has found it. This little pebble I'm looking at, that's totally optimally centered in the heart of our one shared identity. That little pebble. You know, and you see this little frail leaf or little dead leaf on the ground. That little dead leaf on the ground, too, is optimally centered in the one shared identity. Totally. Totally right now. Totally now. And there's nothing outside of that. This is a superior experience than the personality body finding some, you know, wonderful, glorious spot on a glorious day. Right? Totally superior to it. So just letting this stuff sink in. You see, when you're speaking from the level of spirit, we give ourselves time to let this stuff sink in. Whereas the personality, it says it's not quite enough. You can't have any dead air, you know, the personality. Like you look on the media, is there ever any dead air? No, constant jingles and jangles and music and personalities, doing stuff. Can we not just have quiet? Turn on the television, it's just quiet. One reason I watch golf is a lot of the times there is just quiet. They're not saying anything. Someone's lining up a putt and there'll just be silence on the air, you know. Just nothing. Nobody's saying anything. All the spectators are quiet. Everyone's just quiet. See, I just missed that a little bit. Very minimal commentary. Very minimal commentary. Minimal action, minimal commentary. Just be quiet. So watching my golf tournaments, that's something I've always done. It sort of reminds me of the spiritual practice. It's the one instance in this world where it seems like at least we might be faintly reminded of right spiritual practice. So we give ourselves time to let this all sink in. Let me see if I can boost this. The sun is just zapping so much. That just makes it even more. Personality says, come on, say something. And we say, there's nothing that needs to be said except what truth is totally true right now. All truth is totally true right now. There's nothing but truth. And that truth is totally now. There is nothing but truth. And that truth is totally now. Now I'm really fading out. There's nothing but truth. And that truth is totally now. Let's go down like that, and a different variation. There is nothing but truth, and that truth is totally now. Well, you see, it's not optimal taping conditions. Doesn't matter. Because there is nothing but truth, and that truth is totally now. No lies are true now. No lies are ever true. Lies are forever lies. All truth is totally true right now. There's nothing but truth right now. Truth is all there is. And all truth is totally now. Truth is all there is. And all truth is totally now. Truth is all there is, and all truth is forever now. All truth is forever truth. Truth is all there is, and all truth is forever true. All truth, truth is all there is. Truth is totally here now, and all truth is forever true. All truth is forever true. Truth is totally true without a second. Truth is forever true. Truth is forever true. Truth is forever true. There's only one truth, and that is that truth is forever true. There's only one truth, and that truth is all there is. This moment is totally true. This moment is totally true. This space is totally true. This plant is totally true. That shrub spaciousness is totally true. That flower That flower spaciousness is totally true. That walkway spaciousness is totally true. That driveway spaciousness is totally true. That road spaciousness is totally true. That sky spaciousness, that sky, this sky spaciousness is totally true. This room spaciousness is totally true. Truth is totally true. Right now. That road spaciousness is totally true right now. That road spaciousness is the heart of the one shared identity right now. That palm tree spaciousness is the heart, is in the heart of the one shared identity, is abiding in the heart of the one shared identity right now. Walkway is the hardness of the one shared identity right now. Is the centeredness. Is infinitely centered, is perfectly, effortlessly, forever centered in the one shared identity. This table spaciousness is forever centered, is forever centered. One shared identity. The blessing of this centered table is shared with the blessing of that totally centered road spaciousness. That road spaciousness and this table spaciousness share the perfectly centered one identity, the perfect centeredness of the one shared identity. That cloud spaciousness and this table spaciousness are the one shared identity, are equally centered. That cloud spaciousness and this table spaciousness experience the same one shared identity. So in your practicing, you're always waiting and then you try and do it again. You wait and then you try to do it again. You gather your nerve and then you try to do it again. So in other words, don't give up when you say, well, maybe I'm tired, maybe I can't quite get it right now, or whatever. It's like running a wind sprint. You run one, and then you rest, you run another, you rest, you run another, you rest, like that. You keep on doing it. That's how you get into really good shape. Don't run just one and then say, oh, boy, I'm really gassed. No, just get your, you got to run more. Get your wind back, and then run another one. Here come those squadron of crows again. Yeah. The one shared identity is blessed by the presence of this plant. The one shared identity is blessed by the presence of this light stand. The one shared identity is blessed by the presence of this post. The one shared identity is blessed by the presence of this table. Truth is totally revealed as this plant in the one shared identity. The truth is totally revealed as this table in the one shared identity. The truth is totally revealed as this space in the one shared identity. It's not a good trend, is it? That's close. The one truth. The truth of oneness is totally revealed unto this table in the one shared identity. The truth of oneness is totally revealed to this tree in the one shared identity, the vision of one shared identity. The truth of oneness is totally revealed to those stones in the vision of one shared identity. Truth is true, truth is always true, lies are never true, lies are always lies. One shared identity without a second as palmness. The one shared identity without a second as postness. The one shared identity without a second as treeness. The one shared identity without a second as tableness. The one shared identity without a second as catness. The one shared identity without a second as roadness. The one shared identity without a second as skyness. You know, words cannot really capture it very well, can they? We can only practice. They cannot capture it. So the personality is saying, I don't get it, I don't get it, I don't get it. You can't capture it for me and present it to me. No, you cannot. Say that this plant spaciousness cannot obscure the vision of oneness. That crow spaciousness cannot obscure the vision of oneness. This daylight spaciousness cannot obscure the vision of oneness. Can never obscure the vision of oneness. That sunlight spaciousness can never obscure the vision of oneness. That building spaciousness can never obscure the vision of oneness. That flower spaciousness has no power to obscure the vision of oneness, has no power to ever obscure the vision of oneness. This table spaciousness has no power to ever obscure the vision of oneness. Lies can never be true. Lies are forever lies. Truth is always true. Truth is forever true. truth. All truth is true right now. That crow spaciousness has no power to ever obscure the vision of oneness. Things have no power to obscure the vision of oneness. No thing has the power to ever obscure the vision of oneness. No thing has the power to ever obscure the vision of oneness. That road thing will never have the power to obscure the vision of oneness. This body will never have the power to obscure the vision of oneness. These senses will never have the power to obscure the vision of oneness. This day will never have the power to obscure the vision of oneness. This moment will never have the power to obscure the vision of oneness. Truth is always true. All truth is true right now. All truth is totally true. Lies are totally lies. Lies will never be true. All lies are forever lies. All lies are forever lies. This plant has absolutely no power, will never have any power, has no power, and will never have any power whatsoever to obscure the vision of oneness. There is nothing that will ever have the power to obscure the vision of oneness. The vision of oneness can never be obscured. The vision of oneness can never be obscured. And lies will never be true. And lies will never be true. This plant can never be excluded from the vision of oneness. This tree can never be excluded from the vision of oneness. This dirt can never be excluded from the vision of oneness. This walkway can never be excluded from the vision of oneness. These stones can never be excluded from the vision of oneness. This planet can never be excluded from the vision of oneness. This sky can never be excluded from the vision of oneness. This leaf can never be excluded from the vision of oneness. This pine needle can never be excluded from the vision of oneness. That mountain can never be excluded from the vision of oneness. This country can never be excluded from the vision of oneness. This table can never be excluded from the vision of oneness. That rock can never be excluded from the vision of oneness. There is nothing whatsoever that can ever be excluded from the vision of oneness. Truth is totally true. Lies can never be true. Truth is totally true. Lies can never be true. All lies are forever lies. Truth is forever true. All truth is now. All truth is now. Of course, language does fail, but we're just moving our comfort zone. You cannot use language to adequately portray this shared oneness, this seamless continuum. Because everything is in it now. And language perception language automatically gives a false impression. It's not like this plant is included in, it's not like the plant is, a plant is being included in it. It's that you are aware of the, you see, you can't even explain it without giving a wrong impression, at least to the personality, for sure. Spirit can get it, because it says, okay, I kind of see what you're pointing towards. The personality will say, well, I don't understand exactly what you're saying. What's the sequence? You know, is it, this plant is included in it, and then there's other, that plant too is included in it, and so there are these things that are being included, and what is that? No, it's that there's nothing being excluded whatsoever in this very moment. In this very moment, total inclusion. But again, inclusion implies exclusion, doesn't it? So words remain dualistic to the personality. Words are always dualistic. Yeah. And the sense that the sense of dualism is not it. So practice will never be a substitute for actually experiencing a vision of oneness. It can never be a substitute. The personality wants to make it a substitute. Say, if you just do perfect practice, that's good enough. Now, it's impossible to do perfect practice. No such thing as perfect practice. You can say truth can never be explained. I can never explain truth. All explanations are insufficient. Because what are we explaining it to? Something that needs an explanation, something that cannot experience it? If we don't experience it, we can never get it. We have to experience it. The personality can't experience it, so personality says, "I just tell me what it's like, and then I will know how to advise you correctly on how to deal with it." You know, that like that. No. Lies are never true. So instead of trying to explain it directly, I think you have to go about it indirectly, otherwise the personality is going to cause you problems. So you say all lies are forever lies. This really hits the personality hard. And the more you can detach from the personality, the more you deflate it, the more you mute it, the easier it is to actually experience the vision of oneness, which is what we're really after. So it's to mute the personality is very important. When we're in an egocentric, personality-centered state of mind and expectation, we won't see the vision of oneness. It's only when we get into the spiritual state of mind that the vision of oneness can dawn, because we're receptive to it, we're aligned with it. No explanation. No explanation, no practice. This is a technique that some of you know. No teacher, no teaching, no student. No teacher, no teaching, no student. This is a powerful technique. We can use this one too. Absolutely. No teacher, no teaching, no student. But this is not something to get, it's something to practice. And this is, I think, where we can improve, we can improve. Again, if you hear that, say, no teaching, no teacher, no student, what does that mean? And the personality responds to it, that's not it. It's a failure at that point. It's only something to actually practice from a spiritual standpoint. There, no teacher, no teaching, no student. It's a type of acceptance. In the vision of oneness, there's no teacher. In the vision of oneness, there's no teaching. In the vision of oneness, there's no student. There is not. And the personality says, well, what is there? Don't explain, just practice. No teacher, no teaching, no student. No enlightenment, no non-enlightenment. Not this, not this, not this. No teacher, no teaching, no student. Just be quiet. Nothing to comprehend, no one to comprehend. So, of course, we are directing this towards freeing ourselves from trying to relate to the personality. Of course, there will be an experiencing of the vision of oneness. But what we're saying is not at the personality level. That we're not going to go back and try to feed this to the personality. We say, okay, personality, I got it, I'm a teacher. I know what to tell you, and you're the student, and we're going to explain it to you, and you'll be able to get it. No, we're going to realize that that's not going to happen. We'll never be a teacher to the personality. No one will ever be a teacher to the personality. There will be no spiritual master for the personality. So, you know, we're giving that up. We're giving it up. No teacher. No teaching, no student. No teacher, no teaching, no student. No realization, no enlightenment. All aimed at adjusting our expectations, realizing we don't have to explain anything to the personality, and nothing is explainable. Truth is not understandable by the personality. We can get the vision of oneness, and then we think, okay, wow, how do I explain this to the personality? How do I teach this? Cannot, no teaching. No teacher, no teaching, no student. No realization, no enlightenment. No oneness, no vision, no success. The ego personality says, well, how do we use this to get rid of this alien will that's controlling us? I mean, how can we use enlightenment to get rid of that? See, it wants to turn it into a tool to attack and defeat this supposed external will that is controlling our lives. Vision of oneness is not a tool. There isn't anyone that needs the tool. There isn't any external will. There isn't anything excluded from the vision of oneness. There's nothing that needs any saving. And truth is forever true, and lies are forever lies. Okay, so so we need to continue to get even more traction and more traction and more traction. I'll keep working on it. This is just an intense, again, hydraulic pressure. Open the jaws of death that have us so firmly gripped. Just have to keep on prying and prying and prying and prying and prying. And eventually we'll get free of those jaws of death for sure. For sure. All right. Very great. That's it for this one.